in this edition of Art Loft, Salome. Roadside Attraction.
You know, it's one of our true bona fide roadside attractions where you can stop and feed the tarpon. But that story, which began in 1985, is a great story. And people go feed the tarpon, they don't realize how those tarpon first started showing up.
Sand, water, voila.
I would say that the greatest challenge is always anatomy, getting your anatomy right. There's no ceiling to how good you can become in anatomy.
And monster. It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation and
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
From the Florida Keys History and Discovery Center in Isla Mirada, I'm Kaylin James, and this is Art Loft. Welcome to another edition of Art Loft. Coming up, the perils of an excellent imagination, the art of sand sculpting, and more. Now we continue along the edges to follow the path of Salome. Enjoy.
Every brushstroke, a heartbeat. Every color, a breath. One life, beautiful life. This is my journey along the edges of beauty. True love comes like brand new life. It even smells like birth, like salt and sweat and blood. But if it's not reciprocated, one-sided, all in your head, then that feels like murder and it smells like dirt.
Thank you.
more on Anfinsen's work, visit ericanfinsen.com. And for more Wonder Dog films, visit markypearson.com. Up next on Art Loft.
I never really had a plan to become a sand sculptor. It was a happy accident, and very happy about it.
Right here at the Keys History and Discovery Center in Isla Mirada, you can experience Roadside Attractions. In this collection, we take a look at famed overseas highway destinations and a few hidden gems. Come on, let's go.
Roadside Attractions was something I wanted to do. I wanted to show the visitors and the locals alike things they drive past every day and kind of give them some background. So they're driving past, they can also get some, you know, some history of where these attractions came from. I went about choosing the attractions I wanted to display, kind of the things that I've driven past. I've been here 14 years, things that I've driven past and had questions about myself. You see signs for John Pennycamp, Coral Reef State Park. I want to talk about that. You see Betsy the Giant Lobster, but you also see things like the Wild Bird Center, which doesn't get a lot of press and doesn't get a lot of, you know, information right off the bat, but there's so much great history behind the story with Laura Quinn, who created this out of the love that she had for birds and helping them, you know, survive some of the fish hooks and the fishing line and the it getting hit by power lines and trucks. And I wanted to just kind of tell more of the story of things that you pass. I know Robbie's Marina, which everybody has to go by Robbie's Marina. You know, it's one of our true bona fide roadside attractions where you can stop and feed the tarpon. But that story, which began in 1985, is a great story. And people go feed the tarpon, they don't realize how those tarpon first started showing up. So those are the kind of things I wanted to explore in this exhibit. A couple of the exhibits that I really wanted to do, one is Perky's Bat Tower on Sugarloaf Key around mile marker 17. And it's a great story about a man who wanted to build a fishing village, but he knew that mosquitoes were going to be a problem. And he heard about this bat tower from a doctor in San Antonio. And he built the tower and put the guano to attract the bats. He released a bunch of bats and they flew away and it never functioned. But it was a great idea for mosquito control back in the 1920s. Another one of the attractions that is really people drive by every day and never see is the last of the original roadside mile markers left by Henry Flagler and his men during the Flagler's train. And that's located on Big Pine Key. And you drive by it, you don't see it, but it's really kind of a cool, you know, marking from yesteryear. A lot of the photographs for this exhibit are ones that I've taken. I drove up and down the Keys for a long time, pulling over, taking pictures. Some of the historic photographs are from my mentor, Jerry Wilkinson, from his collection. And some of them are ones that I've donated from the facilities themselves. One of my favorite parts about the exhibit is my inclusion of Dennis the Menace when he came to Florida in the 1970s and visited John Pennycamp Coral Reef State Park. And he has a unique little story where he goes out to Penny Camp and goes out on a glass bottom boat and sees the coral reefs and talks with his mom and dad. And that's probably one of my favorite parts. People have come into the center and seen the exhibition on Roadside Attractions, and they really have been intrigued and kind of wowed by all the information and the history behind some of these things. People have lived here for 10 or 20 years who know these things and drive by them every day, but don't know how they became, you know, what they are today. It's really gratifying for me. It's one of the best things about my job, is be able to bring this information to life and share it with the community.
For more information about this exhibition, visit keysdiscovery.com. But there's more to come right here on Art Loft. Up next on Art Loft. So what can an artist do with a little water and a lot of sand? We'll find out when we visit the International Sand Art Competition in Key West. Take a look. I'm
My name is Marianne Vandenbroek, and I'm the founder of the International Sand Art Competition. When my husband and I moved to Key West, I thought, wouldn't it be neat if all the events that we participated in, if we could organize one in Key West? And this year, it just, everything clicked together, and it felt right to bring it together and have it take place. A lot of people have a hard time believing that it really is just sand and water, but it really is just sand and water. There's no frame inside. Sometimes people think the boxes that we put out on the first day is what's inside the sculpture, but we actually use those forms to compact the sand up and then remove the forms before we start sculpting. Key West is such a great venue for sand sculptures because it's the weather, obviously. I mean, it's summer all year round, and a lot of sand sculptors have to make the switch in the winter time to work with snow and ice. And we're fortunate enough, we can just work in our t-shirt all year. The sculptors that are at this event, I've known many of them for years. Fortunately, they all immediately agreed to come to Key West. How can you not? Everybody loves to come down here.
I never really had a plan to become a sand sculptor. It was a happy accident, and very happy about it. My inspiration for my sculpture, it's really hard to say. I really try to go with something visually striking rather than having a deep meaning or something like that. I usually like a dark or creepy aesthetic, so I try to go with that.
Each sculpture received about 7 yards of sand in this competition, which equals out to approximately 15,000 pounds of sand, which they get to shovel on the first day. We have sculptures that are 9-10 feet tall, and we have some of them that stayed around 4 or 5 feet in height. But yeah, 15,000 pounds, it's a lot of shoveling. How long a sand sculpture can last depends on the sand that's used. Not every sand is the same, but usually they'll really start to degrade after a couple of weeks being out in the elements. The wind can wreak havoc, but not as much as people expect. The same as rain, one of the most answered questions is what happens when it rains. And it's not as fragile as people think. The sand that we're using here in Key West is wonderful. It's some of the best sand that we've worked with, and we've had them up for several months.
I would say that the greatest challenge is always anatomy, getting your anatomy right. There's no ceiling to how good you can become in anatomy. When you mix the sand with the water, if it has enough clay content, it has a little bit of the property of the clay, as it sticks a little bit. So you're able to plaster the sand over the art surface. So all the tiny details, they're very fragile, but underneath it, there's a solid surface that you apply the sand on. The thing about it being ephemeral, it's also that you can create it so fast. So if I would make this out of wood or out of bronze or something like that, it would take months to realize. Now I can realize something like this in only 4 days. So I guess this is where the difference is. And this is why it's so interesting, the sand sculpture.
After the competition, the sculptures are judged by each sculptor. They judge each other's work. Criteria that the sculptors use for judging is the wow factor, and really originality is what it comes down to. The temporary art form that sand is, once you complete a sculpture, it's completed, it's done, and I'm ready to move on. So it can be there for months, it can be taken down the next day. It's okay, it's all about letting go, and you get really used to letting things go, which is very healthy, I think.
The International Sand Art Competition will take place again at the Casa Marina Resort in Key West, November 25th through the 28th. For more information, visit sandartkeywest.com.
Next week,
on Art Loft. Up next, a short film courtesy of MIA Animation Conference and Festival. This year's fest kicks off in October. From Stephanie Lin and Thomas Scheck, this is Monster.
Music and education were always really important in my household. My mom felt it was important for all of us, my brothers and I, to play music and go to the art museum and just be exposed to as much art as we could. And so when I was two, my brothers were 6 and 8 years older than I am. They were taking piano lessons already at the house, and one day I walked up to the piano and started playing one of the pieces my brother had been practicing. And they were all shocked, and the teacher said, who taught her this piece? And they said, no one. We didn't even know she could play. And then this piano teacher tested me and found out I had a gift for being able to hear and repeat music. I started piano lessons with a woman in a love in Detroit, and she had a book for me to read the music, and I would always come in, not with those pieces learned, but with the pieces I had composed. So she didn't want to stifle that creativity, so she told my mother to let me continue to create at home until I was older. I always remember my poor father, because he didn't have a musical bone in his body, and we'd sit at the piano, and he'd by accident play a chord that like excited me, and then I'd be like, play that again, and he had no clue what he had done. His hands just acted, and I would get so mad at him because he couldn't, in my mind, you know what you just played. And then when I was four, the Suzuki method was offered for strings for the first time in Detroit. And that's a method where they teach young children to play the same way we learn to speak at home, by imitation. And I just fell in love with the violin. It's just something I love to do. Growing up in the 60s, music was just a part of everyone's life at home. It wasn't about trying to be a professional musician. It was just you sang, you played. It was a way for our families and communities to come together. I've always been curious about my ancestors from childhood. You know, I see certain programs on history channels or public television, and to see what they would go through as they were becoming an adult, maybe some of the their clothing that they would wear, their jewelry, just all the dances, the music. And I felt like there was such a huge community, and I wanted that as an African American, or I wanted to know what was that. So after receiving the MacArthur Award, then that gave me the time and the money and the space to take some time off and to really start to delve in and do some research into my background. I'm like a kid in a candy shop. I love all kinds of music from all over the planet. And I think a lot of that has to do with growing up in Detroit, and because there were so many cultures. One thing I always notice is that strings, violins, or something that violin is related to seem to always be present in all of these different musics from around the world, and just to hear how they were played in a very different way than the Western violin. But my ear always picked up on that, and I always thought it was beautiful. So since my very first record on Atlantic, every record has kind of been different and all over the map. And people are used to that now, thank goodness. They know that I'm not just running after something, but I love all the different flavors. So I just wanted to share these beautiful sounds that I found at the same time trying to find out more about myself and my ancestry. And what I think the most interesting thing, when we play concerts, sometimes afterwards people will say to me, oh, you know, I found out my grandfather also was a coal miner in this area. And then they'll ask me, did you know about this information, or did you read this article? Or I'll give them a name of a book to read, or they'll give me. So we're sharing information, and it gets people really interested in going back and checking out their ancestry and their family. And then for others, it brings up memories that maybe they had forgotten. I think that's really important for us to know from where we come, because I really don't believe you can go forward unless you know that. Some people disagree with me. But I think also when people start to dig into their backgrounds, they see how much all of us really have had similar experiences and how much we are connected, whether we want to be or not. I'm flattered by that when people say that, but that's not why I do what I do. My personal success is something people don't even know about, because it's being able to practice at home and get something that I've been working on for so long and I finally got it. Or going into a classroom full of young children and exposing them maybe to, you know, jazz violin for the first time, seeing their faces beam and light up, that's my success. You know, I try not to say, oh, I'm playing in this big theater or I'm playing in this club. It doesn't matter, because people are coming out to share the music, share the experience. So I'm always thankful for that. But it is nice and prestigious to know, wow, I'm playing in this hall, the Mondavi Center, or I'm playing Carnegie Hall, or I'm playing a hall in wherever. Even if it's just for myself, I feel like I want to continue that journey and continue to explore the music that comes out of that as well. Whether I put it out or it's just for myself, that's another question. It just puts everything in perspective. And that's why then, no matter how crazy of a day I've had, when it's time to step on stage, maybe I've had 3 hours of sleep, maybe it's been like 27 flights in 21 days, or maybe, you know, who knows, I didn't eat, but I'm blessed to be able to play music. And, you know, as my granddad would say, beats a stick in the eye. So.
Thanks so much for joining us this week. Let Art Loft inspire your creativity every day by visiting wpbt2.org/artloft to watch past episodes. And don't forget to get social with us on Facebook at Art Loft SFL and on Twitter and Instagram at Art Loft SOFLA. I'm Kaylin James, reminding you to stay creative. Bye.
I got on t-shirt and tennis shoes, you know.
What do you see?
He's like, oh, you tell me, baby. All those light checks.
In this collection, we take a look at, we take a look at famed overseas highway. Yes.
Me, I'm the curator.
How you doing? We might as well wait. Whoever that is loud. I'm moving a lot. I don't know why. Okay. Ah, monster!
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, and
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.